Thanksgiving or Festivus? While you were stuffing yourselves full of turkey, watching football with friends, and trying to avoid talking politics with your family on Thanksgiving, President Trump was celebrating another kind of holiday tradition, the airing of grievances. In a call that is traditionally meant to give thanks and support to our men and women in uniform serving overseas, Trump instead battered them with a wild and wandering list of complaints, most of them about how unfairly he's been treated. On a call with a U.S. general in Afghanistan, where there's an actual war going on, he complained about the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals for failing to rule in his favor against asylum seekers. He complained to a naval commander in Bahrain about unfair trade deals. He complained to a U.S. naval commander on the USS Ronald Reagan about electromagnetic catapult technology on Navy ships. And then he boasted to an Air Force general about his authorization of the use of deadly force at our southern border. Now, it's hard enough to imagine this bizarre, self-aggrandizing display being performed with our armed servicemen and women as the unwitting props in Trump's airing of personal grievances. But now imagine it all happening from the comfy confines of the family resort at Mar-a-Lago, where the president got some R&R, played some golf, and was regaled by music from the Phantom of the Opera in his lavish ballroom. While a world away, fathers and mothers are separated from their families for months at a time, risking their lives every day just to keep us safe. Well, after the airing of grievances, though, and comes the feats of strength. In a subsequent Q&A with reporters, Trump sounded off on a host of other topics. He defended his daughter Ivanka's use of private email for government business, something a bipartisan group of lawmakers has objected to and pledged to investigate. He defended his decision to believe Saudi Arabia's explanation for the killing of journalist Jamal Khashoggi, publicly questioning his own intelligence community's assessment that Prince Mohammed bin Salman was directly involved. After months of complaining that his political enemies should be prosecuted by the DOJ, Republicans issued subpoenas for James Comey and Loretta Lynch. And after ordering a comprehensive report on the effects of climate change, the administration quietly dumped it on Black Friday, when it turned out it contradicted just about everything the president has said and tweeted about the topic. Here's the deal. Trump is not a king, but he sure acts like one. The military, the Justice Department, Congress, his intelligence community, all just there at his disposal to use or ignore for his own benefit. But that's not how this works. That's not how any of this works. So with a change in the balance of power coming, will anyone tell him that? For more on this, let me bring in chief political correspondent for Esquire, CNN political analyst Ryan Lizza, and CNN political commentator Amanda Carpenter. Thank you both for spending at least part of your Thanksgiving weekend here in New York with me. I do appreciate it. Amanda, Trump is clearly under the impression that the Justice Department is sort of his own personal attorney, that the military are his toy soldiers, that Congress are his gatekeepers, his stooges, Fox News is his media. He's had it pretty good for a while. Is that about to change, though, with the new Democratic House?
Yes, if they want to be aggressive. But I think there is one thing that is guaranteed that petrifies him and maybe explains the anger that he has at Treasury Secretary Mnuchin. Mm. And that's the fact that the Democrats are going to get his tax returns. There is an old 1934 anti-corruption teapot dome era law that allows the Ways and Means Chairman or other people's jurisdiction over taxes to simply request a president's tax returns and view them privately. Mm-hmm. It does get dicey because they can't disclose it without a vote, but they can use the information they glean to talk to other lawmakers, perhaps about other investigations that are ongoing. And so what we saw with the Justice Department with the sacking of Jeff Sessions was that Jeff Sessions is out, so Trump could get a much more political player in that position. Mm-hmm. I think he's looking at getting rid of people like John Kelly, Kristen Nielsen, Mnuchin, potentially, to get political players in those positions who will protect him.
Right.
Absolutely.
Who will continue to do his bidding. Thank you for that terrific President Harding. I appreciate that.
Let's all go relive those
days.
We might have to. Yeah. Although they did get Nixon's tax returns.
That's
been there with Watergate,
true.
Too. So
Harding
we can relive a lot of history.
Harding may look okay at the end of this term.
No, he might turn out all right. So, Ryan, we're going to talk more about Trump's relationship with the military in a coming block. But how bizarre was Trump's call with those military leaders on Thanksgiving?
On like a Trump scale of 1 to 10, it's in like the 8 to 9 range.
That's a sliding scale.
He is not, what's the proper term? He's not context sensitive. Mm-hmm. In other words, he rails about whatever is on his mind to whomever is in his vicinity. If he were sitting right here, it wouldn't matter that you are interviewing him on TV, right? The kid who's mowing the lawn at the White House or a general in Afghanistan, it's all the same. It's whatever he is railing, thinking about at that moment that he's hopped up on, that's what he unloads about.
No matter who's but there it's also, so what it just, day it is.
Absolutely. Right. So we get all of these examples of him just being completely inappropriate. Like he started his administration at the CIA talking about the crowd size and talking about all of these things behind a wall of stars memorializing dead CIA agents. So he doesn't care about the context of what he is.
Because
it's constantly inappropriate.
None of this kept him from getting elected, Amanda, but as we saw with midterms, there might be some consequences. Do you think now that Republicans are a little bit against the wall looking toward 2020, they coerce him to be a little bit more traditional or mindful of some of these orthodox?
I think you could look for a few people potentially to exert some pressure on him, and that's vulnerable Republican senators going into 2020, like a Susan Collins, perhaps, who may choose to weigh in on an issue here or there. But largely, I mean, this is Trump's party. The people who voice opposition to him have been silenced or they've shown themselves the door, like a Jeff Flake. And so if you want accountability, you have to look to the Democrats at this point, because it is Trump's party and nothing's going to change that going into 2020 when he is the default nominee.
So next week, just pivoting forward, he's heading to Argentina to meet with G20 leaders, including Xi Jinping of China, Vladimir Putin of Russia.
Two of his favorites.
Yes. Do you think Republicans may be sort of aware of the optics, aware of what just happened with the midterms? Do you anticipate any Republicans saying ahead of that, can you just keep it on the straight and narrow for like 2 days?
Well, I don't think any Republicans, now that the Democrats are in power in the House, are suddenly going to be a break on his behavior or what he's doing. If anything, I think now they will have even more of an excuse to be enablers and defenders.
That's what the Democrats
they're
do.
Gonna, right. And there will, of course, there will be Democrats who overreach, who do things that are politically bad for them.
Yeah.
And Republicans will be there to point it out. They're now in more of a traditional role as defenders of their president.
Right.
Now they're not in power, so they'll have no shame about that. And you know, on foreign policy, every once in a while, you know, you're talking about G20, so there are occasionally the Rubios of the world who sort of pipe up and say, tisk tisk, I don't think you did that exactly correctly.
Or the Corkers,
or the Corkers, who's now gone.
It's gone, right?
But that's the second part of it.
Yeah.
All of the people who were his critics, the Republicans, the leaders, they are either retired, defeated, or in the case of John McCain, a deceased.
Yeah, that's
so
true.
So he now has a much more Trump-like group of Republicans on the Hill.
Amanda, quickly, I want to discuss the Ivanka Trump email controversy for a minute. Current House leadership is promising to investigate that, and we all see the hypocrisy in her using private email when, Trump suggested locking up Hillary Clinton for doing the very same thing. Ivanka wasn't running for president at the time, but my question to you is this. Does anyone care about hypocrisy? I feel like that was baked into the
case. We need a stronger word.
Yeah. And he has turned hypocrisy into like a care of the elites. I care about hypocrisy. I think you probably do too. But do voters?
I think there's a broader question that's bigger, that gets you more to the idea of what is Ivanka doing there? Who cares about her email? I mean, I do. She's not following the rules. When you go to the White House, you are told you have to conduct official business on email. This is very basic stuff she's not paying attention to. But again, why is she there? What is Jared Kushner doing? And this gets to international complications with Saudi Arabia. And so, yeah, we can talk about emails, but it would be, it would be a failure not to go down
the
meaning
iceberg,
of this.
Ryan, Amanda, thanks so much.